Hello everyone. Hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo. Friends, today we are going to learn a tutorial on enterprise value to sales, which is called as EV to sales. Again, this ratio is used in many manner. I mean, there are so many usefulness and how this is important in terms of financial modeling. Let's get into it. At the very first end, what you can see over here is box APO is a revenue, that is the profit and loss account details, the revenue details. So let's get into it, what exactly we're talking about. The total operating expenses given, which has been highlighted. There is a loss of operation, which is in terms of EBIT. The net loss is given over here. So basically the enterprise value to sales, have a look basically on this whole above box IPO financial model with the forecast. And what we note in the box is making losses not only in the operating, but also at the net income level also. How do you value such companies that grow fast but are free cash flow negative? So in such a cases, we cannot apply the valuation multiple like PE or price to earning ratio due to negative earnings, or EV by EBITDA ratio, that is if EBITDA is negative, things are not possible, or DCF approach where FCFF is negative. So the valuation tool that comes to our rescue is earning value to sales. So now let's get into the nitty-gritty of the same, and let's learn what things can be done about when the situation is in a turmoil case. So basically, what do you mean by enterprise value to sales ratio? See, EV by sales ratio is a very interesting ratio. It takes into account the enterprise value, and the enterprise value has been compared with the sales of the company. Okay, see, we get an idea how much it costs to investor relative to per unit of sales. So from investor point of view, there are two interpretations that are most important. First, if EV to sales ratio, if this ratio is basically higher, then it is considered that the company is costlier. And it is not good bet for the investor to invest into, because they won't be getting any immediate benefit out of this investment. And if the EV to sales ratio, if this is lower, then it is considered to be a great investment opportunity for investor, because when EV to sales ratio is lower, it is perceived as undervalued. Okay. And then if the investor invests, they would get really good benefit out of it. So if you are investor and thinking of investing into a company, but don't know whether it's a good bet or not, calculate enterprise value to sales ratio, and you would know if it is higher, then in that particular scenario, stay away from the investment. If it is lower, go ahead and invest into the company subject to the other ratio, because as an investor, you shouldn't take any decision on the basis of just one single ratio. Now let's understand the formula of enterprise to sales ratio. EV to, I'll just write for you, EV to sales ratio is equal to HOI. Let's start with the enterprise value. To find out the enterprise value, we need to know the three specific things. One is known as the market cap. So I'm just writing the numerator, that is EV, that is the market capitalization, the debt that is yet to be paid, cash and bank balance. So market capitalization plus your debt less the cash balance. So now we need to find out how each of them should be considered. See, market capitalization over here, as you can see, this is the value that we get when we multiply the outstanding shares of the company into the company share price. So how should we calculate it? Let's say there is a company who has the outstanding shares of 10,000 and the market price of the share is 10 per share. So what is going to be the market capitalization? That is 10,000 into 10. That is 1 lakh, right? So the next is the outstanding debt. See, is outstanding debt is the long-term liability, and the firm needs to pay back in the long term. And the next is the cash and bank balance. They are the liquid assets of the company, which needs to be deducted from the sum total of the market capitalization and outstanding debt. We have understood all the components of the enterprise value. That is the first portion, that is EV. The next is we have to understand sales in this ratio. So what would be considered in the sales ratio? When we would take sales, it is net sales. The sales over here is basically your net sales. Now, Or and not the gross sale. So a gross sale is a figure basically which is inclusive of the sale discount. So we are taking over here the net sale and other sales return in the gross sale. So we would take the net sale, and that means that we need to exclude sales discount and the sales return from the gross sales to get the right figure. Now let's see some of the examples of EV to sales ratio. Now let's look at few examples to understand how to calculate the enterprise value to sales. So we will look at very simple example first, and then we will illustrate the ratio with two complex examples. The first one is that we have the following information: market price of the shares, outstanding shares, long-term liabilities and cash and bank balance and sales. So let's go and compute. This is very simple example. We have everything over here. We'll first calculate the market capitalization. We know how to calculate the market capitalization by computing the outstanding shares and the market price per share. So market price per share is 15, outstanding share is 1 lakh, which gives you market capitalization as 1 lakh 50. Now let's see how we can compute the enterprise value. Market capitalization that we have got from here, that is $1.5 million, and we had other details like long-term liabilities and cash and bank balance. So when we add over here the debt value of debt and deduct the value of the cash and bank balance, which gives you your enterprise value. So we know that over here the enterprise value and the sales is already been mentioned, so we can easily assess the sales ratio. That is, enterprise value over here is 3.46 million, okay, and your sales is $100,000, which gives you how much your EV to sales as 3.46. So depending upon the industry, the investor needs to understand that this 3.6 is a higher or lower ratio. Then the investor can decide whether to invest in the company or not. Let's get into the example number two. Let's look at this example number two. So over here there is a detail of market price per share. This is book value per share. Book value of shares, this is per share and of shares. There's a debt over here, cash balance, and gross sales. So we'll have to adjust this sales return over here to get the net sales right. So now let's compute the enterprise value to the sales ratio. So in this example, the computation is a little bit complex. Nothing much is there, but little complex. We'll decide and we'll be able to compute the market capitalization. So let's find out the outstanding shares at the very first end. The book value of the share is given 2,50,000 over here, and the book value per share is given, which will give you, when you do the book value per share, book value of shares divided by the per share value, it gives you your number of shares. Okay. Now, when you know the market price per share and know the exact number of the outstanding shares, then we can basically compute the market capitalization as well, because market price per share and the number of shares, if you have both the things, if you multiply, your answer will be your total market capitalization, which is your outstanding shares per share value and your market capitalization. Now you have both the things. We have now the market capitalization, that is 3 lakh over here, and we have to add long-term liabilities less the cash and cash equivalents. That will give us enterprise value, and the sales will be gross sales and adjustments for sales return. That will give us our net sales. So over here, our gross sales is 1,50,000, 1.5 million. Net sales is $400,000. That is $4 lakh. So your net sales is going to be 1.1 million, right? So now it is, see, it's very simple. Because you have your earning value over here and you have net sales is over here. So when you combine both the things, you get your earning value to sales ratio as 5.0x. So the enterprise value to sales is 5x, which is higher or lower depending on the industry that the firm operates in. So if your EV to sales ratio in industry is usually higher, then the investor can invest into the company. And if it is not the case, the investor need to think twice before investing into the company. But as an investor, it's a primary importance that you check with all other ratio to come up with the concrete conclusion. Now, my question is that when to use this EV to sales ratio? So at the very first end, EV to sales ratio is first, it is very difficult to game from the accounting point of view. Though EV to sales ratio is a very crude measure, it does not provide us with a great insight on how much are we paying for the company per unit sales. Second, the EV to sales can be very helpful when there is a significant difference in accounting policies. So when there is difference in accounting policies, then the problem will come into picture. And the PE ratio, on the other hand, can be very dramatically with changes in accounting policies. The next is third point. EV to sales can be used for companies with negative cash flow, negative free cash flow, or unprofitable companies. See, most of the internet e-commerce startups are running unprofitably, like Flipkart, Uber, GoDaddy, etc. can be valued using the EV to sales ratio. GoDaddy operating loss, it can be calculated with the help of EV to sales ratio. Fourth, EV to sales can be useful for identifying the restructuring potential. Very important. Restructuring potential. Now, Andrew Griffin, he noted in his discussion on restructuring at Alcatel-Lewin, was reporting losses with each year and was valued at close enough to 0.1 EV to X to sales of its EBIT margin percentage. Divide by 10. So if the EBIT margin was to be around 10%, then in that scenario, it should trade at close enough to 1x of EV to sales ratio. So if it was expected to be around, let's say, 5%, then 0.5 EV to sales, it should be close enough to 0.5 EV to sales. So Andrew expected that the company will reach at least 3% EBIT margin, and hence it looked undervalued. Got it? So now let's compare which is better, EV to sales, that is my first question, and or price to sales, which is a better ratio. Let's compare this. See, the first thing first, the price to sales ratio is technically incorrect. The price per share over here, as you can see, is the price at which one can basically buy a share. That is, it belongs to the shareholder or the equity holders. However, when we consider the denominator over here, that is the sales portion, it is pre-debt item. That means that we haven't paid any interest, and hence it belongs to both the debt holders as well as the equity holders. Okay, this means that the numerator belongs to the equity holders and the denominator belongs to both the equity and the debt holder. That makes apples to orange comparison, and it's therefore incorrect. However, when you still find many analysts using this ratio, but in price to sales ratio, an analyst may use market capitalization to understand how much it costs to purchase the company. However, in price to sales ratio, debt is not considered. If a company has a huge amount of debt in its capital structure, then the valuation inferences drawn from price to sales will be incorrect. And that's why earning value to sales is much better ratio than the price to sales ratio. Now I'll give you one example of GoDaddy, and let's see some details regarding it. Can you see the graph over here? EV to sales 3.695 and the price to sales as 1.538. So basically, we understand following concept, enterprise value, we know the formula. And when do you think that enterprise value will be different from the market capitalization? This can happen when debt minus cash is a significant factor. Over here, the long-term debt, see the long-term debt 1039.8. The total stockholders' equity is 425.8. So GoDaddy's balance sheet revealed that the large amount of debt, that is 1039.8 million. And its debt to equity ratio is greater than 2x. However, GoDaddy has a cash and cash equivalent of 3.352, right? So in that scenario, the contribution, that is debt minus cash, is pretty significant, because you can see 1039.8, and hence both the ratios differ. So if you see the contrast with Amazon price to sales ratio and EV to sales ratio, it's very nearby, 2.852 and 2.719, right? So Amazon debt to equity ratio is low, 0.75x, and they have a huge pileup of cash. Due to this, debt minus cash does not contribute meaningfully an enterprise value of Amazon. Therefore, we note that price to sales and EV to sales of Amazon are similar. So finally, let's see what are some of the limitation of our ratio, that is earning value to enterprise value to sales. See, enterprise value to sales is a very good metric to find out whether to invest in a company or not. However, it is based on many variables which may change in a matter of days. And it's not recommended that investors depend on single ratio for an investment. The investor should go ahead and look at different ratios to come up with the concrete information before investing their money into any investment. So in the final analysis, if you know how to compute EV, that is enterprise value, you should never bank upon only market capitalization, as the debt should also be considered in equation. Thank you, everyone.